It's a beautiful day in this beautiful city of Dharamshala where I am right now in the mountains. There's a bit of a chill in the air, there's sunshine also. So weather is transitioning. But I think with the weather transitioning, I can also feel that Earth is also transitioning. And with that, the whole human consciousness is also transitioning at this very moment. And from some time, with every passing day, there's a vision that's taking deep root in our hearts. All our works are driven by this vision now. It's a vision for a new humanity. It's a vision where we learn to respect life as a precious gift, as an opportunity for conscious evolution, where relationships are rooted in love and compassion, where businesses are done with the spirit of collaboration and well-being for all, where education instills inspiration and hope, where knowing the truth becomes the underlying aspiration in whatever we do, where joyfulness becomes our constant state of existence, and where leadership in all spheres of life is much more awakened. That's the vision that's getting or taking deep root in our hearts. So today's program is one step towards that vision. So thank you everybody for participating. As GP said, I'll set the framework first. You know, very late in my life, or very late in my sadhana, I would say, I chanced upon Bhagavad Gita, very late, just a few years ago. It's a phenomenal work. In the third chapter, which is on Karma Yoga, there's a very beautiful statement which Shri Krishna makes to the Arjuna. The statement says, whatever actions are performed by great people, common folks follow that. And whatever standards the great leaders set by their exemplary action, the whole world pursues that. So in just one statement, we can see that from thousands of years, there's a certain focus on leadership. We knew as a culture that leadership is of paramount importance. Whatever a leader would do through the exemplary actions, the whole world will pursue that. Yeah. So there is a certain responsibility that comes to the leaders. Hence this topic or this work to work with conscious leadership. You know, in 1999, I'm going back into the history, in 1999, in Japan, there was a wonderful man called Masaru Emoto. He did a phenomenal experiment on water. Very famous, some of you might have heard about that. So what Masaru did, he took some water and he gave words of appreciation. He spoke words of appreciation, words of acknowledgement, words of love and compassion to this water. Then they tested the water under the microscopes and they found that the crystals of waters have really become really beautiful, like diamond. Then with the same water, he spoke some words of hatred, looking down upon, some negative thoughts, comparative thoughts, angry thoughts, jealousy, words full of jealousy. They just spoke those words and then he took the sample of that water, put it under the microscope again and saw the crystals of water became really ugly. The power of words, the power of thoughts. When he spoke compassionate words to the water, it became diamond. When he spoke words of jealousy and hatred to the water, it became very ugly. It is very famously known as the water experiment, but I think it is not a water experiment. It is really a compassion experiment. Every human body, 70% of us who we are, is water. So what we speak to each other, what we pour as energy, as thoughts to each other matters. So as leader, it depends on us. What words are we sharing or putting to our teams, our colleagues, our families, our friends, our even unknown people on the road? Because every word that we speak is changing the chemical composition of the body. And this experiment shows that. So, and compassion, why I'm calling it compassion experiment? Because compassion is not a new word for us. You know, 2500 years ago, Buddha made this as a fountain point, as a fundamental thought for setting up the whole human journey. It's a very old concept. But somehow, and today I think we should discuss that, somehow we've not built human life. We've not built consciousness as the, let's say, as a base for human life or human existence, of all our relationships, of all our actions, somehow. There are very quickly 7 key points I want to set up as a framework and then open the discussion with the beautiful powerhouse of panelists. First, very quickly, let's look at compassion. What is compassion? When the word compassion we hear, we think it's about, you know, becoming soft, not being able to take tough decision, sentimental behavior and things like that. Well, that's not compassion. This is an attribute. This is a human attribute which has probably helped our species survive for 200,000 years. Yeah. The definition of compassion is recognizing the suffering in somebody and then working towards removing that suffering. That's what compassion is. Now, when we look at the workplace, our colleagues, our subordinates, our bosses, our stakeholders, there's a suffering in everybody. It could be a heavy word, but here the suffering means pressure, stress, you know, winning the target, winning the contract, performance, yeah, pressures on all kinds of, you know, interpersonal, you know, things that happen between the teams. All of that put a lot of pressure. It is a form of suffering. And the definition of compassion is first identifying the suffering in somebody and then helping remove that suffering or working towards removing that suffering. And you can only do that if there's a certain strength. And when there's a certain... Okay, I'll come to that point later. So the first thing, this is what really compassion is. The second point I wanted to establish is that's a very natural phenomena. It's something given to us as by nature, as a gift. It's not something that we learn from outside. It's always given to us. I call this compassionate instinct. As nature has given us so many other instincts, so compassion is also one of the instinct given to humanity and to a lot of other species, by the way. I'll give you an example of that to prove it. Have you ever observed when we go on social media, on YouTube, on Facebook or wherever, you know, there are these very popular small videos where you see one animal is suffering or one animal is trying to attack the other animal or one animal is stuck somewhere and there are some few people go and release that animal from that suffering. Or when this chase is happening, one animal is attacking the other, somehow we very glued to that moment on the video. We are seeing it because somewhere we want to see the outcome. And we watch it till the end, till the time the animal is not released by this human intervention. Or if the chase was happening, if the animal gets freed from the chase, win back his life, we feel a sense of relaxation. Now, we were not doing anything there to release that animal, to help that animal who was suffering. But internally, everybody, we watch the video till the end because we want the animal to be rescued. Why? It's a natural instinct, compassion. When you watch that video, compassion takes root in your heart, it gets activated, and you want, subconsciously, you want that animal not to be hurt or to be saved. Right? This proves that it's a natural instinct. This also proves that even if somebody else is performing an act of compassion, we feel good about it. Even when we are not directly engaged in the act of compassion, we feel good about it. Yeah. So hence, it's a natural instinct. Third point I want to establish is, and this is specifically for the corporate professional business world, you know, life is a holistic process. It's not a divided process. But often I've observed that when we enter into the work mode or professional mode somehow, we carry our intellectual skills, our mental abilities to the workplace, but we do not carry our emotional abilities to the workplace. Somehow we don't allow our heart or our heartfulness to express itself in the workplace. So we do not enter into our work modes holistically. Yeah, we leave the love and compassion part behind. We don't talk about it in the professional circuit for some reason. And today we're going to explore that. Because, as we just talked about, this is something which is inherent in all of us. This is something which is an instinct given by nature. If you try to suppress it, then you cannot be whole in your work mode or in any mode that you perform. And life's growth depends on being a holistic being. working as a holistic being, interacting as a holistic being. That's where life starts to evolve. And when life starts to evolve in you and starts to grow in you, that is when you start to have a deeper impact on the business, on the teams. We'll talk about that. So that's the third point I wanted to establish, that probably it's time to humanize the business. Yeah, with this gift of compassion. The fourth point I wanted to talk about is that compassion can be cultivated. What can be cultivated? That which comes from nature. So a seed comes from nature. You put that seed in the soil, nurture it, and the seed, you can cultivate a big tree or even a whole forest from one single seed. So the seed of compassion is already in our heart, given by nature. It can be nurtured and can be cultivated to become a rich, big tree, which can have a much larger growth than we can imagine. Think about this for a moment. The next point I wanted to establish, that, you know, we all human beings, we are very receptive beings. We are receiving all the time. Remember the water experiment? The words, even that I'm speaking in somebody's absence, the words have power, the words have energy. There's a certain intention in every word. If the words are full of positivity, it's impacting the team or the person to be more evolved, to be more impactful. If the words are draining, negative, then it's sapping the energy out of, or the motivation or the inspiration out of that person. So which then means compassionate atmosphere or compassionate behavior has a very direct result or very direct influence on people around, on your teams, on your customers, on your all stakeholders. Water experiment. Yeah. So it has a very, very strong, powerful impact on the people around you in the organizational structure or social structures. We can equate it with also mother. You know, there are tons of experiments and researches have been done now. If for a certain reason a young child, newborn, is not able to get mother's love and compassion for some reason, even the physical and mental growth of this child gets hampered. There are tons of psychological research been done on this subject. It's a proven science now. As against, if a child which grows with a lot of love and compassion from mother and parents and people around, from the community, the growth of this child is very different. He or she is a very flowered child, very positive, very impactful, very happy. Yeah. So compassion has a very direct impact on the teams. And it comes from an understanding. You know, there's a shloka that I'm remembering, very beautiful, from the Shastras, from our Indic wisdom. It says, Loka samasta sukhinam bhavantu, which means we knew that from 10,000 years that every person out there needs to be happy for my happiness. I can't be happy and content if people around me in my organization, in my work culture, are not happy, inspired and content. So my inspiration, happiness and contentment depends on people around. Yeah. So compassion has a link impact on everybody here. The other thing I quickly wanted to establish is that it could really be a game changer. You know, we've never looked at compassion as an attribute which can really change the game. Yeah, but it can really be a game changer. I think we've just been talking about, or we've too driven with the B2B and B2C thought. I think it's time we need to establish H2H thought. And H2H could be human to human, or even heart to heart. If you go a step deeper, it could be heart to heart. In my workplace, do I consider everybody as a human being and give absolute freedom, trust, respect, gratitude, guidance, nurturing, which every human being deserves on this earth? Or am I looking at a human being as a B2C, customer, or B2B, business? What is the view? I think we've come to a stage in life where this new thought need to be imbibed by all of us, especially in the business world. H2H. First level of H2H, as I said, human to human. Second level of H2H is heart to heart, even a step deeper. So this can really change the game. And is this something new that we're talking about, compassionate leadership? Or this is very old and established? And I've heard it from very respected R. Gopalakrishnan of Tata's. You know, Tata's in 1892 established the first trust, which recently there was a survey that in the whole century, last 100 years, Tata Trust is the biggest philanthropist across the globe. Rockefeller and Bill and Melinda, they're all behind, much behind, $102 billion. 100 years, that's what they've pledged for the social work. Look at the impact. They were the first one to introduce, let's say, employee welfare schemes, insurance schemes, health insurance schemes, even Provident Fund, if I'm not wrong. That is where the whole tradition of employee welfare probably started. The fact and the result of it is that in Tata Steel's, to the best of my knowledge, after 1929, there was no strike. There was never even a single strike in the Tata Steel, if my data is correct. So two things we are establishing. A, we are establishing that it's a very old concept, you know. Jamshedji Tata has implemented it, you know, 130 years ago. And it can be a game changer, and it had a very, very strong positive impact on the brand Tata's and on the workings internally in Tata Steel. Yeah, though you are the expert in that domain. Yeah, but this is just, I picked up from a very beautiful talk of R. Gopalakrishnanji. So with this framework, I think let's open the dialogue. I invite all the panelists now. So first of all, let me invite Dwarkaji. Dwarkaji, I wanted to ask from you with this 7 points that I just shared. Can you share from your vast experience example of certain companies who practice compassionate leadership styles even now?
Namaskar. Good morning to all the viewers and my fellow panelists. Anishji and JP, thanks for having me here. I'm privileged and honored to be here today because it's not that I'm going to add value, but I would be able to learn more from all of you. Especially, I'm delighted to have a very distinguished fellow panelist here. So having said it, let me start with a disclaimer, Anishji. I am neither a social scientist, nor a spiritual leader, nor I am an authority on this subject. Whatever I am going to share is from my just practical experiences. I've worked as a practicing manager for nearly 5 decades, and I'll be happy to share. And more, I'm here from the young leaders, whomever is less than 25 years, like Raj Kamal and Anand are young leaders for me. And some of the very seasoned leaders like Dr. Jaikumar, VCG, as well as Alkaj. So this is my submission at the beginning. Just to start with, I have 2.5 minutes.
Yes, yes, yes.
The time can start now, please, if you don't mind. See, you said many things. I just focus on few things. For me, compassion is the quality of having positive intentions and real concern for others. You said, share me some experiences. It is no doubt true in the corporate world. And my experience of relating to corporate world, I'm talking at a macro level, how it can impact on teams and stakeholders, both internal and external stakeholders, also how this can be a game changer. These are the two themes which I'm focusing as a given example at a macro level. I think one of the best examples I can give you is from SmithKline-Beecham itself. The purpose, I think for me, a corporate world, culture of the organization, the architects, the leader, tone at the top is very important. I think if you set the tone, then you'll have a great influence on other fellow team members, board members, and stakeholders per se. You see, to start with, when the mergers have taken place, especially SmithKline-Beecham I'm talking about, the focus on this is to demonstrate positive intentions and a real concern and care for others. It said, the purpose it said, our global quest is to improve the quality of human life by enabling people to do more, feel better, and live longer. You see, the focus was on the in improving the quality of human life. Rest are all consequential actions. Feel better, live longer, happier, and so on. So what do you mean by quality of human life? How do you improve the quality of human life? The next statement said, whatever consumer brands we produce, it should stand the test of law. Clinically, it should prove that it can enhance the quality of human life. It could be a great statement, cliche, which many companies do it. But the purpose has been very clearly articulated by the leader and the top leadership team. What does it mean? When you talk about Horlicks, which was our brand till recently, the tagline says, to give you an example, it should be, you know, it says taller, stronger, and sharper. This Horlicks will give you, make you taller, stronger, and sharper. But, you know, we couldn't say to Bill Cream or Yardley talcum powder or to just to give Tabasco Sass, which are the most cash cow brands. The important things, they are earning huge profits. But as an organization, as a leader, Bob Bowman said, it will not align with the purpose of the company, which were created a new company. So what did you do? You may say commercially, you are not savvy. He said, we are here for profits, but not for profiteering. So we said, we hived off this, which has given so much of strength to the employees, though there were a lot of debates. The way you communicate this, cultivate that, you use the word, you can also cultivate the compassion. We care for people, both for our patients' care, and we want to be transparent in what you do, and we take accountability what you do. So this is, I think, is the greatest example at a macro level I can sue. By virtue of it, we lost millions of dollars, but in the process, we earned the respect and earned the goodwill of the stakeholders, be it patients, be it hospitals, be it customers. So this is one example which I would like to allude on, and coming very quickly on a micro level. You see, when you say giving the care for people, sometimes the institutes, we go to campuses, oh, this company is a very soft. For me, if you are soft, it doesn't mean you are tough. I think a compassionate leader not only gives positive and negative feedback, but constructive feedback. He's willing to take tough decisions with a human touch. So it, what I call the embrace the art of tough love, tough on issues, but soft on people. Otherwise, GSK, in the so many mergers we have done, we couldn't have done the sort of managing the workforce redundancy, but no whispers are given because the way you handle them with care, respect, and dignity, with a lot of empathy, has created this. So this is a one aspect. While closing it, what is the brand in GSK India? I said when the winters were there in Delhi, I'm talking about 70s. Today, everybody gives paternity leave. I don't want to talk about all this. But this is, we care for women leaders when you go home, women employees, for safety. So there was a lady winter taxis right from 78 till now, till we moved to Gurgaon, that all the ladies have been taken in a pool in the evening to ensure the safety, especially when you are in central Delhi, where the loss of used to be crime on ladies. This was accepted as a best practice by ladies. Many people have joined because this company cares for women. So these are the two examples. I thought I will give it as an opening remarks.
Wonderful, wonderful. So enlightening. Thank you, Dwarkaji, for such beautiful examples. Very relevant. Very relevant. So let's move to Anand. Anandji, you do a lot of work, and you know, GP described you as the happiness expert. I wanted to ask you, is there a connection between personal happiness and act of compassion? Is there some kind of a connection?
Yeah, definitely, Anishji. Lots of studies to prove that. Two, three reasons for it. We are, as human beings, a pro-social set of creatures. If you look at in the whole evolutionary tree, human beings actually develop outside the womb a lot more than inside the womb. So many of these animals are born a little bit ready to face the world. But it is human beings who need the nurturing of people around us to survive. And the fact that we have survived and flourished for so many years means genetically we have been selected to have the seed of compassion that you mentioned in the earlier part of the discussion in us. And so that's the first starting point. So we become happy naturally when we are compassionate. There are two major studies that I will say that you know, really lend credence to this. One is the largest study on happiness and health done by Harvard University. It was conducted over 75 years. And the person who presented was the fourth research director of the study. So 724 people in the US, half of them Harvard graduates, and half of them from very poor neighborhoods were followed up for 75 years. Every 2 years they were studied, you know, their health records were taken, they were interviewed, their field questionnaires, their near and dear were interviewed, and their life was followed up for over 75 years. And today, 90 out of those 724 are alive. You know, this study started when they were all about 18, 19 years. And what the researchers asked, you know, what should happen in the middle age of those individuals for them to live long, happy, without dementia, you know, without blocks in their heart, without so many of those things. And they realized that the one thing is that they had enjoyed warm relationships. That seemed to stand out as the biggest contributor to their health and happiness later in life. So when they had warm relationships, even the pains that life inflicted on them were bearable. And if they didn't have those, even the smallest of irritations became magnified. So this is one thing that clearly proved that, you know, that's something. But what I'm saying is that, you know, they have to have received warm relationship. But how do you receive warm relationship if you don't have a general friendly disposition to the world around you? And therefore you seed warm relationship, because as human beings, we sort of imitate, right? If something good happens to us, we immediately pay it forward very naturally. So compassion is at the heart of a very healthy and happy life. I think that's one big study that proved that this is at the center of a good life. The second one done by Fredrickson, where she basically divided volunteers into three groups and showed them instantaneously either very sad, angry kind of videos, negative emotions, or very positive, arousing videos like humor or serenity and so on and so forth. And then those which have neutral videos. And she found that when they were all given problems to solve, the one who had the more positive videos, who watched the positive videos, were actually more creative in their response. They were able to think of wider amount of options. And again, you know, in retrospect, it is very natural. So when we are feeling threatened, lonely, we tend to focus on our survival. You know, the threat perception makes sure that we are focused on something immediate, urgent, and we are not able to look around the edges. And in today's world of high volatility, organizations need creative response to succeed, and creative response is clearly aroused in the presence of positive emotions, and positive emotions are clearly aroused in the presence of a compassionate environment. So very clear linkages by research to show that, you know, compassion is extremely important for human flourishing as well as organizational flourishing.
Wow, excellent, Anand. With this whole subject back with such intense deep research from such large institution, you know, it puts a lot of credibility to this. So beautiful. Thank you, Anand. I come back to Dr. Alka Mittal again. Dr. Alka, I wanted to ask you that, you know, you represent a large public sector institution, you know, so in a large public sector where there's a certain perception, image that we have of a certain kind of culture and the size in itself, what do you think? Is compassion something which can be practiced easily, or there are what sets off? What's your input on that?
Right. Thank you, Swami Anish, I would say, and all the panelists who are here, distinguished panelists who are here. And I will just begin by saying that public sector, by the very nature of its of the institution, is a very inclusive organization where we have people from different class, different corners of the country, different economic backgrounds. They are eligible to apply for these positions, and they get selected also. We have a multicultural organization. We call it a mini India. And there we, by the very nature of the kind of surroundings we are in, a kind of environment we are in, we become more inclusive, more sensitive to the needs of others. And we want to make everyone who's a part of this organization comfortable. And in this spirit, when we are, compassion blossoms, I would say, when we are working in this spirit, and we have different age groups there. We have youngsters who learn from what the seniors are doing by way of caring for others. And ONGC as such, as an organization, is an organization that cares.
It's better.
And in light of that only, I would just give one instance which conveys what I'm trying to convey right now. There were, during the pandemic, we had our workforce which was working in different locations, you know, in the onshore as well as offshore. For an extended period, beyond 14 days, they worked for 60 days. They were on distant offshore offshore platforms or onshore locations, and they were away from their family for over 60 days in place of 14 days on-off pattern that is there. So, and every time we ask them, they would say, no, nation needs us. We are there to provide energy to the nation, so we'll continue. But we realized after 60 days that it's high time their families need them too. So we at the top leadership level, we took a call, even though the lockdown was there, we charter hired flights, the Air India flights, created a bubble for them and transported our colleagues from different locations to the platforms and from the platforms to their respective families. And the beauty of it is, one way I'm trying to convey the compassion at the leadership level, the beauty of it was when we were trying to contact colleagues, you know, in the midst of pandemic, when people were not wanting to step out of their house, we were trying to contact the colleagues, you know, if they would go to the platform to relieve those who were there for 60 days. So I got a call from a person in Jammu. He said, ma'am, all my colleagues have been contacted. I have not been asked if I would be going to the platform, because I would like to serve my nation and my and provide relief to my friends also. So I had to tell him that you are in Jammu, we are not charter hiring flight from there. So rest assured there, and we are fine. We know that and understand your care for others. So this is the environment which is created in a public sector, because they are working for a larger cause. They are working for the nation, and they are all together in it. So they care for each other. I'm sure Agarwal sir will convey the same sentiments, because in IOC also, being a part of a huge public sector, he would have come across such instances.
Yeah, so wonderful, Alka ji. Such a warm incidence that you shared, which shows two way of compassion from the top leadership and also people who really want to serve their country at the most difficult time. Wonderful, wonderful. Such heartwarming story. I come to VC Agarwal ji now, since we're talking about stories. So VCG, any example or success story from your personal or professional life about where you've learned from a compassionate leader personally? Any such example would you like to share with us?
Namaskar. Respected Sri Anish ji, Dr. GP, Sadhu Sangha team, distinguished panelists, and my dear participants. It's a great privilege for me to join this August gathering. I will get the opportunity to learn more from here instead of sharing my experience. I am working in the current group. It's a diversified private group, RP Sanjeev Goenka group, since last 11 years. Just now, Alka ji has shared some experience of the public sector, and therefore I will not go back to my experience of Indian Oil. It will become almost repetition. So I will share my experience of working in this diversified private group. For this purpose, we have more than 24 companies in our group. For this purpose, I tried to analyze 8 companies out of 24. And what I found that out of 8, the performance of 6 companies, I will just share on what parameters I analyzed. Performance of 6 companies was excellent as compared to the other 2 companies. The parameters on which I assess these 8 companies, revenue growth, profitability, share price, attrition rate, employer brand, and benchmarking in industry. And what I found, surprisingly for me also, that in these 6 companies, which have done excellently well in last 5 years or so, then I tried to analyze the characteristics of these CEOs who are leading these companies. And somehow I found that they have the similar kind of characteristics. And now I will share with you what characteristics I found in these CEOs. They are humble. They have emotional connect with team. Just now, Anish ji has shared heart-to-heart connect. human to human or heart to heart connect. So this is similar to that. Emotional connect with the team, caring, transparency. Organizational agenda takes priority over the personal agenda, and effective communication. I found similar characteristics of the six leaders, six CEOs who are leading these six companies. Coming to the specific example, I will take one company by specific example. By name, I will take now. Its name is Saregam. Previously, it used to be known as HMB. Now it is Saregam. The current CEO of the company, he joined on 27th October 2014, 7 years back. Before his joining, the CEOs were not staying for more than 2 years. Maximum stay was 2 years. The working environment was political, mistrust, and the company performance was also not good. In last 7 years, the revenue has grown 266%, profit has grown 600%, and share price has increased. On 27th October, the day when the CEO joined, it was 169 rupees. And on 23rd September, the last week, it was 3875. So it has increased by around 23 times. The CEO is still continuing 7 years. The leadership team is continuing. Attrition rate has come down. The actual performance parameters I have just shared with you. And this has the name in the market now in the entertainment circuit. So what I'm trying to share this here, that the style and functioning of the leader of the company, it has the direct impact on the employees and the performance of the company. This is a limited point I wanted to share with you.
Wow. Excellent. Excellent, VCG. I mean, this is such a phenomenal example and research. I mean, this has really proved that compassion can be really a game changer, huh? Not just in the personal space, but in the business sphere also. Very, very beautifully shared. Thank you, VCG. Such invaluable research and the outcomes. Very inspiring. We, after listening to you, we just hope that we had bought the shares of Saregama 7 years ago. All right. Lovely. Now I'll move to Raj Kamalji. You know, she comes from the financial industry background, which is Raj Kamal, largely financial industry, you know, in the banking sector focused on B2C. Huh? Now we're using B2C in a contextual format in the B2C. So how do you train your teams here who are, you know, facing the customers every day? How do you train your teams to be more compassionate towards customers' need in such a large financial setup where numbers are almost everything?
Thank you, everyone. Good morning. एक तो बहुत बड़प्पन है सबका बोल रहे हैं कि भाई हम यू नो यंग लीडर स्टार हैं बट द्वारका जी हु इज माय मेंटर एज वेल एंड जीपी जी इधर आई जस्ट वांटेड टू काइंड ऑफ एक्सटेंड माय ग्रेटिट्यूड फॉर देम फॉर बीइंग ऑन द सेम पैनल शेयरिंग द डायस विद देम लेट मी स्टेप बैक द क्वेश्चन दैट यू आस्क इज पर्टिनेंट बट लेट मी स्टेप बैक यू नो वन ऑफ द थिंग्स दैट वी रिकॉग्नाइज एंड दिस इज अ कन्वर्सेशन दैट ऑफन वी डोंट हैव Most people, when in their corporate life, will say, okay, you know, I want to do something for in service of others after retirement. Or you'll say, you know, I want to do something which I'm passionate about after working. You know, little do we realize that it is work in which you spend the maximum amount of time. And actually, you're doing the biggest service by serving others. And that recognition and that conversation perhaps is not as amplified. One of the things that when we were looking at our brand, and I'm coming to Axis Bank specifically, our tagline, if you realize, is they'll say open. And the reason for they'll say open is, and we were doing customer research and all of that, and one customer said, vyapar to sab kar lete hain, par vyavhar ek do log hi kar pate hain. And you know, you come back not for vyapar, but vyavhar. It is such a powerful thing because, you know, especially when you look at technology and other digital enablers that have come in, everything has gotten commoditized. What has not gotten commoditized is ability for us to be human. And for us, Dil Se Open is that tagline where we are celebrating each and every person. And if you look at our ad, and everything is hinged around the person, not the convenience, not the access, it is the person. And to do that, they were prior to getting into training, you've got to also say there is no one template. There is no prescribed formula, and people are imperfect. Actually, one of the things is celebrate imperfections. Embrace your anxiety. Embrace the fact that maybe we're less than perfect. You know, it's such a, and don't think only from head. Along with head, get your heart out. And for us, that's the celebration of Dil Se Open. And training from then on is stories, fables. You know, how do we learn culture? Right from dadis, nani, your parents are talking about stories, you know, whether it's the crow who puts the pebbles, or the lion and the mouse story. All of this have beautifully gotten embedded in our social fabric through fables and stories. And I think we often don't tell stories, even at our dinner table and even in our organizations. And the organizational success story should not be about just how much market share. It's about the person impacting that vyavhar, doing that service for others. And that's another way that we actually collect stories every year. And every year we have a compendium of, we call it the values book. We release an edition of the brightest and the best, some 50 stories that go out, and those get kind of embedded in the culture again and again, especially as you're dealing with customers. And recognition of the fact that people, there are also internal stakeholders, internal customers. Customer is not what you kind of serve outside. So the, you know, the idea through all of this is to kind of amplify our search for purpose and meaning. And in that sense, I think one of the beliefs that we have is in this decade, be it the compulsions of growth and everything else, our biggest distinctive factor would be the ability to be human as leaders, to serve others and accept imperfections.
Wow, wonderful, wonderful, Raj Kamalji. And the tone that you've set up, you know, India is the land of stories. And if you do that in the corporate world, and I'm very touched with this example, I think we should talk about it one-on-one later. And the second thing, you know, from vyapar to vyavhar, I mean, this one thing can change lives of individuals and the corporate cultures. Just this one statement. Wonderful. Thank you. This is such an invaluable contribution today. Excellent. Since we're talking about stories, I want to invite Dr. Jay Kumar to listen to some stories from his personal life about, you know, role of compassion, or, you know, some acts of compassion, or something which compassion has enabled, so to say. You know, any stories, Jay Kumar ji?
Good morning, everyone. Thank you very much for this opportunity, Mr. Anish ji and GPR ji. I'm extremely delighted to be among this elite panel of Dwarka ji, Anand, Alka madam, Agarwal, and Rajkam. Thank you. I resonate with what Mr. Dwarka ji said. According to me, compassion is quality of having positive intentions and real concern for others. That is the genuine concern coming from the heart. Compassion is being thoughtful and sensitive to others' lives and experiences. Various researchers, Agarwal himself has done a research, and Anand spoke about various other researchers which his institution has done. It has been proved that compassionate leaders are more engaging. They build trusting relationships. They make them feel connected together. They bring in a lot of collaboration within the organization, a sense of commitment, increase the employee satisfaction, reduce the turnover, bring in high morale. So various researchers have proved this. Coming to a large organization like us, sometimes people feel that, is it possible to have a compassionate leadership? Because you have to have, when it is a large varied organization, you have set norms, procedure, rules, etc. But all these things can be framed in a compassionate mindset for a greater good. See, Mr. Dwarka ji said, as well as another V.C. Agarwal said, if you look at our vision statement, it says L&T shall foster a culture of caring, trust, and continuous learning. for all its stakeholders, whether it's employees, society, etc. So care and trust is the foundation of compassionate leadership. So certain things which we've done during the pandemic stays testimony to that fact. Unfortunately, with all the preventions we took, there were some loss of lives. We ensured that their spouses or children are given an employment in the organization. We took care of their educational support of their children until they attained the post-graduation. Medical expenses have been taken care of. Sometimes the wife or spouse is not employable. So we put them through a three-year program to develop them, make them employable, and then that's going an extra mile and showing compassion. Even at a society level, distribution of oxygen cylinders to all the hospitals, many such things are done. At an individual level, if I go, I have n number of examples. There are people where last 3 years, due to some problem, became paralyzed to some thing. We are paying the salary, taking care of the insurance, seeing that we can, how we can recover and get them back to employment. So I have a whole lot of examples to talk about. Being the paucity of time, I stop here, Anishji. Thank you.
Wow. Thank you, Jay Kumarji. These are, again, you know, these are such beautiful, warm examples of showing that how large institutions like even L&T are, you know, building a compassionate culture and taking care of even the, you know, the bottom of the pyramid, so to say. Yeah, such amazing examples. Thank you. Thank you, Jay Kumarji. GP, I come back to you quickly. How are we doing on time? Please guide me. You're on mute, GP.
I think it's fine. I took a little more time in the introductions, but then we're going time, no problem. We are at 12. So okay, you can carry on for another 15 minutes.
Okay. Wonderful. Thanks, GP. So I'll squeeze in a few of the questions, because otherwise, you know, there's such phenomenal thoughts and inputs coming from everybody. I come back to you, Dwarkaji. One of the things is that, you know, at such a senior level you've served, and you still continue to nurture and mentor, you know, thousands of people, I hear. So there's this whole thing about, you know, leaders developing leaders. And when leaders are developing leaders, how do you make sure that you cultivate or you sow the seeds of compassion in them so that it starts to cultivate? Yeah. So what's that? What's that tool? How do you do that? How do you ensure, you know, leaders are also getting trained on compassion?
Anishji, it's a great question. From my perspective, you know, firstly, we need to go with some surmises. Leadership should be at all levels. Everyone is committed and everyone can contribute. That is the principle of GSK. If you have that, then you can develop, cultivate the compassion also to make them more human. As you said, it can be developed, and I strongly believe, and GSK also believed it very strongly. Just to give you, it all depends, you know, Rajkamalji has talked about the storytelling and others have shared. The important aspect is, how do you give that respect to the person that you can be developed as a compassionate leader by their own acts of the leader? That's why the tone at the top is important. I think you just want to give one inspiring example which I'm influenced, which helped me to develop others, is Dr. Charatramji. When I was working with him in DCM, one day he called me and he said, I'm giving you a very tough assignment. Dwarka, you are going to Lucknow. I wish your luck starts now. You know, the words, your luck starts now. This was said in 1970s. I'm talking to you, relating to you after 48 years. What does it mean? In inspiration, that means he cares for you. He has called you as a chairman of a company. I'm just a middle-level manager, and you are encouraging me because he must have realized something in me. I think this spotting, identifying talent for business is one aspect. Whether you have that human touch, whether you can be groomed and cultivate the compassion, is very important. And the second example I would say, then we can talk about many examples, is most important aspect is when, you know, when somebody, a lot of redundancy takes place, how you deal with that at the time of redundancy, the communication, the respect and dignity is very important. Here is a guy who worked with you for 35 years. Out of, you know, he outlived his utility, but you want to treat him well. You call him and give him a package and say that you are 3 months, you would serve notice. After that, you know, you will be serving this as a benefit. This question was, please give me 6 months, adjust my salary. I said, what is the matter? He said, you see, look, my daughter is getting married. I worked in this organization for 35 years and I'm a big leader in that small village town in a factory where he's located. If you go him, it will be seen as a stigma. I think here my submission is break all the rules when you apply. It doesn't mean that, you know, you flout the ethics or the compliances. But within that, as a HR, as a leaders, we need to tweak the rules in the sense, in a positive way, to provide that care. That compassion, I could earn it because Dr. Charatramji has taught me what a compassion is by doing small things. Everything need not be big. Ultimately, it is not the money. We have adjusted the money, but the way we treated him, he always talks about it. So these are the important, when you're developing leaders, that is how the last bit I want to conclude, Anishji. There is a difference between positional authority versus personal care. Don't think you are, as a chairman of a company or a group HR head, you will, what you try to train them or cultivate them, they will listen, unless you have the personal credibility. That is why I give more importance to positional authority versus personal credibility, which goes even after Dr. Jaikumar is not the head of L&T, people would talk him and advise him, what should I do? That gives a credibility. That is what I have experienced it. So you may have competencies, you may groom him, but ultimately this emotional quotient, which makes a difference between a great leader and a good leader.
Wow. On this, you know, the automatic response is wow. And that comes when, you know, something comes from such a deep space in your being and received at such a deep space. So I think this is really, really wonderful that how you can even tweak the rules, but person or persons, that moment is extremely important. And I can, you know, vouch from my own personal experience, Dwarkaji and Dr. G.P. Rao, you know, even after, you know, you're not, you know, I mean, semi-retired, so to say, if I may use that word, the respect that you have in the industry, people look up to you, people want to be you. And I think that's just because of the seeds of compassion that you've sown throughout your life. Yeah, so very, very beautiful, touching. Thank you. Thank you, Dwarkaji. Thank you, Dwarkaji. So wonderful. Moving on. Now we're entering into a little direct area, and I come to you, Anandji, that such brilliant thoughts on compassion and even real life examples are also coming from the business industry. But somehow, I still feel that it is not happening, Anand, the way it should happen. The scale of compassion, the regular practice of compassion in the business world, in the industry. What went wrong, if there's any? Why did we miss this such an important element of, you know, human nurturing, and which also has a direct impact on business? Any thoughts, Anand? What went wrong? Why is not part of our regular discussion in the corporate?
Very, very good question. Actually, if it is so obvious, why is it not practiced at scale in the corporate world? So I think two or three things come to my mind, Anushi. So one, I think, you know, people have thought of organizations as machines, right? And therefore they have designed processes, errors, minimizing errors. So they have long looked at organizations in that mindset, and they have forgotten that organizations are actually the product of human interactions. So take some of the, you know, brilliant things that we use today. So if you take a Google Map, for example, and if we were to, you know, sit back and imagine how Google Maps would have been created by the team, it would not have been one person, you know, imagining everything and then giving it to somebody else and then saying somebody coding it and somebody testing it. That's not how it would have happened. It would have evolved in people sharing dreams about how this product will be used. So there's a lot of, you know, human personal involvement in the creation of something very, very magnificent. And in the way we thought of business, we have sort of mechanized it so much. So to that extent, we have removed these things away. So if you take the COVID vaccine that has got developed around the world, how many people would have collaborated, shared their dreams, you know, looked at something beyond self to produce a vaccine in a very short period of time to come here. But it's, we have somehow misunderstood the how value is created in organizations and felt that great processes, people following rules will create value. What creates value is when people put their emotion, their dreams, they share, they collaborate, they shape each other's thoughts, that's when value gets created. So that I think is one of the things that have gone wrong. And secondly, because of this mechanized mindset, so people have said that whatever is unnecessary must be removed in organization. And when they have removed, they have thrown the baby with the bathwater. So that's really what they have done. So look at an interaction where you are trying to develop someone or giving feedback to someone. So some people spend the first few minutes trying to relate to the individual and then keeping a, you know, the right interpersonal climate between them and then wondering whether something like this will work or not, right? So that's what somebody does. Some others think that the point has to be direct. They give a lot of evidence. The first person, even though they spent a lot of time to set the stage, will actually get the work done, will actually make the change happen, will actually develop the individual. The second person who thought it's all unnecessary is bombarding with feedback will be met with resistance. So this thing has not been understood. Even in the midst of a war, right? One of the grandest wars that took, Krishna took the time to set the interpersonal climate, right? Krishna took the time to relate to the individual. Krishna took the time to empathize, saying that I know what you are feeling, right? This is what you are feeling. And he could have said, I am God, see my Vishwarupa and accept what I say. But then he took the time to set the stage. And somewhere, this point has been misunderstood in the mechanized view of organization. We thought something that is not directly seeming to add value should be removed. It is like removing the lubricant from the automobile, right? It may work, you may save some cost, but ultimately the machine will break down. So I think that is the trick that we have missed. It is like, you know, the Buddha and the Angulimal. Angulimal was traveling very fast to kill the Buddha, but the Buddha was traveling very slow, but he still couldn't catch up with the Buddha. So sometimes by being slow, we can be very fast and effective. And that realization has to come. And I'm sure it will come when a little bit more people, when there's a critical mass that turns, organization will suddenly change to be very compassionate organizations. I'm very, very hopeful that that will happen.
Wow, excellent, Anand. And personally, I'm also very, very hopeful that that will happen. And not just that will happen, that must happen if our species need to grow collectively. That's the only way forward, so to say. Wonderful. And I love the Krishna is one of our favorite. What a brilliant anecdote there. Excellent. Thank you, Anand. Thank you very much. I come back to VC Agarwalji. A very quick question, VCG, that compassionate leadership or compassion as a trait, do you think it can be developed? And if it can be developed, any quick suggestions on that? Very quick suggestions on that.
My straight answer is yes, it can be developed. And the most effective way of developing compassionate leadership is, I will go back to Dwarka Ji, that put the person with some compassionate leader. And there is a saying in Hindi, kharbuje ko dekh karke kharbuja rang palatta hai. So that with that process, there will be a very good effect on the person whom we are trying to develop as a compassionate leader. And the other processes can be enhancing the emotional intelligence, self-awareness. Coaching is also very effective at senior level. So these are the few things which I have experienced for developing the compassionate leadership.
Wow. Excellent, VCG. You've touched upon such a brilliant point of, you know, which Buddha said 2500 years ago, the mantra, Sangham Sharanam Gacchami. This rubs on to the others. If you practice it and put people around a person who's really compassionate, this rubs on to other. The effect of Sangha. Very beautifully said. Thank you, VCG. Thank you. Thank you very much. Come back to Raj Kamalji. Any examples of direct business growth, Raj Kamalji, of compassion or any, you know, we've been talking about stories, any success stories? If the stories could be on connecting with the direct impact with business, yeah, because we're mostly business people. So how do you make use of compassion, cultivating skill to enhance the business?
For us, you know, the as I said, vyapar and vyavhar mein agar vyavhar theek hai, toh vyapar badhta rahega. See, one of the things that we forget in business is people have needs, but if you trigger the emotional response, the need gets converted into want. And that want, if leveraged by businesses, manage makes up for repeatable business. That's at the human level, especially in the service industry. It is very critical. If you serve somebody well, if you were empathetic, if you reached out and helped out, and help is such a powerful emotion, especially in customers' perspective, obviously there is a repeat business. I don't have to say about it. But I think the second part is also if you're open to serving different communities, like in early this month, we kind of put out, we put out a charter for Come As You Are. And it actually, Come As You Are was a charter for including transgender people who are from the LGBT community to open bank accounts. And where did it emanate from? It was again the same philosophy of Dil Se Open, where we realized in a circle head in Punjab realized that the communities of Hijra, they typically don't save money. They save money and they open proxy accounts. They may not be opening accounts themselves. And again, it that was the germ where they said, why aren't they opening? And the person, the circle head went around and figured out how can we be more open? So I'm saying there are numerous examples. If you're open and leverage that power, there is business need. But I think at the broader level also, and you started the example saying that we can't be isolated. We are social animals. We can't be isolated from the planet. And if you look at in recent times, especially this decade, given the pandemic and everything else, will be about ESG, environment, social, governance. And ESG will be such an important metric where investors will also look at you. What are you doing to contribute to the climate, to the planet? Are you being green? And it's again another form of the organization practicing conscious capitalism. I think you started initially saying, what is to be human? Being human is to understand that you're conscious and you are consciously responsible, you know, in very, very difficult terms. And I just want to, towards the end, I want to highlight, I made a point about accepting imperfections. And I saw some questions where people said, you know, if I accept imperfections, will I be termed as strong leader? I think if you accept your vulnerability, not only do you gain trust, but you are seen as a person with immense courage. So it is in our head where we've only got our head, right? We've only got templates, black or white. But the gray is the one which is messy, which is fun, which makes us human. And we talk about technology leading to N is equal to one world. Compassion is essentially looking at human beings as human beings, not as an account number, not as an employee code number, not as a resource, but a person who we can multiply and figure out and manage the ecosystem.
So wonderful. Huh? So you've nailed on edge to edge, huh? Human to human. So beautiful. So beautiful. I now come back to Dr. Jay Kumar very quickly. And this is also an important point, Dr. Kumar, is that, you know, there's a perception that if you show, as Raj Kamalji said, you know, your vulnerability as a leader, though in my opinion, you know, a great leader will absolutely show his or her vulnerability. That will make the leader great. Yeah, absolutely transparent. However, there's a popular perception that if you show compassionate side of yours to the world, you will be taken for a ride. People will take you for a ride and take advantage of you. Yeah, and this is a broader perception. Huh? What would you say on that in the absolute corporate context?
Good question, Anishji. There was a tweet by Jeff Weiner, the ex-CEO and the present executive chairman of LinkedIn. It says, big misconception about managing compassionately is that it is a soft skill. Most compassionate people I know are typically the strongest. It was a tweet there. So let me address it with three null hypotheses. There are a couple of doctors in the panel. One is, being compassionate means you cannot hold people accountable. No. It is a clear no. This is a wrong thinking. You can be compassionate and also hold people accountable and set high expectations to them. Researchers have proved that. They set clear expectations in terms of behavior, outcome, expectations, and they are very open and candid to give feedback also. Hypothesis number two, being compassionate means letting things slide. No, it doesn't mean shying away by taking difficult stuff. Because it is not in anybody's interest. A compassionate leader works in the interest of people. So at times he has to take tough decisions. Then if you come to the hypothesis number three, being compassionate means falling into the trap of sympathy seekers. No, it is also proved negative. Being compassionate doesn't mean that you are responsible for others' feelings. It is more of empathetic listening, trying to understand the issue, helping the people to discover the own solution. It is more like a counseling approach. So being compassionate is not weak, nor people will take advantage of that. It need to maintain a balance.
Excellent. So in a way, you put everything together that, you know, if there's an honesty and directness about you, authenticity, then you can bring both these two seemingly opposite traits of being compassionate and being strong or being direct at the same time. You know, this is how life is, bringing the opposites together. And I often give the example, Dr. Jayakumar, of the river. You know, often river is, when we talk about river, we give the example of being the flow. Yeah. We never think about discipline when we talk about river, because that's the part which gets missed. You know, every river has a deep discipline of its boundaries. If the river leaves the boundaries, you know, it will create havoc. So with the flow comes the discipline. With the compassion comes the strength also. Beautifully said, Dr. Jayakumar. Yes, GP. Yeah. So there are lots and lots of questions. So I think looking at the time. Yeah, we'll have to. Yes. So one pertinent question, which is kind of a repeat I'm seeing, is, and I'm not giving the name of the person, I'll just phrase it in my own words, is that, you know, this is a very fast-paced tech world. We're all behind the screens. We're all working from, you know, homes or different locations. Can compassion be practiced in such a work culture? And if yes, how? I come to Dwarkaji. Any thoughts, Dwarkaji, on this?
It's a very, very pertinent question, Anishi, to put it. I think this is where you need to get the balance of high tech and high touch. I think this technology is bound to exist and it continues to be so. The only thing is the way it may happen in future, maybe hybrid, many other mixed versions can happen. But I think this is the challenge. I think this is where it doesn't mean that you use technology, you can't caring, you can't give a personal touch. But personal presence and feelings are a little bit different, no doubt. But the best way to handle this is how to create the balance between high tech and high touch, like we maintain balance between lives and livelihoods.
Excellent. High tech and high touch. What a beautiful analogy. What a beautiful way to explain it. Excellent. Beautiful. Thank you, Dwarkaji. And then there's another question which says, does acting compassionately depend on the situation? I'll quickly take it myself and connect it with Dwarkaji. What you also said is that, you know, even when we are behind the screens, when we're working from home, etc., we're not saying that compassion must be practiced only in the office, only in the workspace. Wherever you are, there's an opportunity to cultivate compassion. Even if you're sitting alone in your room, and I'm saying alone in your room, you know, there are ants and there are mosquitoes and there are flies and there are all forms of life around you. We can start to practice compassion even there. So this is a great opportunity where we start to practice compassion first within our own self, around us, whosoever is available, whatever form of life is available, and then take it to the larger environment when we get the opportunity. Yeah. And this question which says, you know, does acting compassionately depend on a situation? I would personally say absolutely not. Compassion is your inner state. Yeah. If you are with your inner state, then situations do not matter. As Jayakumarji very beautifully said, in certain situations, you need to act tough. But when you act tough, you act from compassionate space. We talked about the situation where some employees had to be severed. With the deep gratitude and with the deep dignity and respect, we allow or we make sure that the transition of the employee from the company to somewhere else is very, very smooth and respectable. Yeah. And we do this extreme act of, you know, it's like severing act. We do an act of severing with a deep compassion. Yeah. I'm very quickly reminded of a tradition which is still practiced in some parts of the world, where there are hunter-gatherers still. These are people who live in the tribe. Their livelihood is dependent on shikar. You know, they have to kill an animal and eat the animal. Now they go out and kill the animal with utmost compassion. So I've actually seen them fishing. They will go in a small boat in a lake to fish. Before they're killing the fish, they actually have a deep prayer for the fish. They say, thank you very much for saving our life, for feeding my family. Your life is being used. And I deeply apologize because there's nothing else to eat. I'm coming to you. Yeah, I'm not getting into the debate of non-veg or veg. I'm talking about the tradition that they kill also somebody, an animal, to serve their family, to make sure that they survive. And they do this act with utter compassion. Yeah, so it does not depend on a situation. Okay. Somebody's asked the same question. I think we should talk about it a little more. The situation when we have to ask somebody to leave from the organization. Can you give a specific example of how can you be compassionate at that time? Some specific examples. I come to Jay Kumarji. Any specific one-liner?
There are incidents where I had to terminate somebody, but I had used my own influence to find out a job for that person in another organization. We go an extra mile. He has been asked to go by various reasons. Okay, he may not be the performer. You call a 8 rating, you may call a force rating, 1-4 rating. My 1-4 rating and forcible termination, in spite of things, may be a better person for another organization, right? It's not just sending him off. As Dwarka Naji said, giving 6 months, a couple of cases have come like that. I have asked for 3 months. Yes, we have to terminate. I asked me 3 months of time so that he can find a job. I said, okay, you stay at home, look for a job, find out, and then we'll go. So based on the situation, based on thing, you have to take a decision. You have to break rules, but it's not for individual purpose. If you are make an exception out of it and pass it across.
Excellent. There are many incidents. Excellent. Two quick questions, GP. Allow me to take just two quick questions. One, very interesting. Another friend asked that, you know, when you act out of compassion in a certain situation, it can be seen as discrimination by the opposing party. Yeah. How do you avoid that? You can be blamed that you are discriminating against set A versus set B if you're acting out of compassion in a certain scenario. How do you prevent that is the question, and I come to Raj Kamalji for that.
I think policies, templates, actually policies have dehumanized everything, because then you say, okay, everything is fair. But compassion is trying to reach out to the person who needs it without the boundaries of policy and SOPs. And once you do that and you talk about the why you've done it, I don't think it will be the bias or will be seen as bias or preferential treatment. And that's when I said celebrate differences, not tolerate them. If you don't reach out and if your policies are still homogenized, then you're tolerating differences, not celebrating them. So that's the difference that we need to kind of highlight and spread it in the culture as well and organization as well.
Excellent, excellent thought. Quickly, Anand, any one-liner from you on this, on the same question?
So I think way to avoid that is trust through transparency. So publish the exceptions that you have made and why you have made them. And if it turns out to be wrong, say that I am personally responsible as a leader who took this decision for anything that might have been looked like a bias. So, but the first act of saying that, you know, these are the rules, but in these 7 instances, we did this for these reasons and we took the decision and as leaders, I think will settle the matters, because you are reporting what you are doing to a larger group of people. So trust through transparency is the way one can possibly break that kind of misgiving.
Excellent, excellent. One last question, and I think somehow it's directly addressed to me. It says, how do you define compassion and is it possible to learn it as an adult? Well, we've defined compassion already, but again, quickly, let's summarize this. It's an ability to see suffering in somebody. Not just that, not just ability to see the suffering, but an ability to also act to remove that suffering. Yeah, so two component, ability to see the suffering, recognize the suffering, and an ability to act to remove that suffering. You know, so that's what we call as compassion. And the second part is, can you learn it as an adult? You know, there's it's not about the age thing. It's like, we've used some bit of Hindi during the session, so I'll use another small line of Hindi. You know, jab aankh khule tabhi savera. The day I realized that compassion is a human instinct, but somehow I perceived it wrongly. I never nurture it, but the seed is still lying in my heart, is the day I start to nurture that seed and it starts to cultivate. And that day does not depend on your bodily age at all. After so much wisdom we've received from you, one more, we're a little greedy, Dwarkaji, one more last line of wisdom.
To be a compassionate leader, tone at the top is important. And you should be ability to manage from Mali to Malik.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh. Your statement, Dwarkaji, today, or maybe always it's like that, huh? From Mali to Malik. Wow, wow, wow. Wow, wow, wow. From the gardener to the owner of the enterprise. Wonderful. Wonderful. Same tone. Wonderful. Wonderful. Jay Kumarji, changing the batting order.
Sir, to practice to bring in a culture of compassionate leadership, first of all, we should lead by example. Set a role model and walk that talk. Second is practice self-compassion. First of all, many times we are very harsh on ourselves. Mm. We have to start practicing self-compassion. If we do a mistake, we feel that, yes, we can correct it. We learn from that. That is important.
Beautiful. Huh? Practicing compassion on oneself. Such a brilliant thought here. Very, very important. Because usually when we talk about compassion, we look at the other. You know, how can we be compassionate to the other? But self-compassionate. Wonderful, wonderful. VCG, one-liner from you.
We say that in the organizational context, HR people play a very important role. They are the interface between employer and employee. Therefore, what Anishji said, the first sentence, recognizing the suffering in somebody and taking steps to remove that. And in this process, HR people can play extremely important role.
Wow, wow. Excellent. Huh? So ball comes to the HR leaders there. Huh? FYI, everybody. I'm not saying anything. Huh? Okay. Anandji, I come back to you.
So I think for every act of compassion that you have received, that you recollect, pay it forward two times. Wow. And very soon, the whole world will be viral with compassion.
Wow. Excellent. Excellent. Wow. Wonderful. Wonderful, Anand. Wonderful. Pay it forward. So beautiful. Raj Kamalji.
So I was just looking at and trying to synthesize everything. For me personally, I think the point that you made, we bring our whole selves to work. So practice compassion, care in conversation, the three C's. Have conversations with people beyond work. And that's when you will practice it. Don't just focus on numbers. And this needs to start from the top. Mali to Malik, jo aapne bola, everything. It is conversations which are so beautiful. And those human interactions make us really real and make it come alive.
Wow, wonderful, wonderful. Dr. GP Rao, I want one liner from you also. You are an expert at that.
Since the topic is compassionate leadership, amongst all the competencies leaders have, compassion is something. It's nothing to do with your experience or qualification. It's a real, genuine, authentic, last longer. That is about compassion.
Beautiful, huh? As always. Perfect in your one-liner also. Huh? And my one last bit on this before we enter into a quick next phase is, you know, there are three broad faculties we've all been gifted with by nature. The faculty of head, the faculty of hands, and the faculty of heart. In the last session, we talked about it in deeply, that heart is one of the most strongest faculty we have. But in order to activate that, we need to do things with our own hands, creativity. We need to, so as Raj Kamalji also said, if we can allow ourselves to bring all three faculties in the workplace, yeah, and make our life as an integrated whole, not a divided process, I think world will be a really beautiful place and businesses will be very fun to do.